wondered how the ocean's chemistry came to be? Like, how did it get so salty? Where does it get its nutrients? How has its salinity changed over Earth's history? Are there changes in ocean composition that are going on currently? And if so, how are they impacting other Earth systems, like climate or ecosystems?
Well, that is exactly what I'll be talking about in today's video. How the ocean's composition has kind of come to be throughout Earth's history, and how it's currently changing, and why, and the effects that might have. So first and foremost, how did the oceans form? Well, over 4 billion years ago, water vapor was pretty rich in the atmosphere due to outgassing, like I talked about in the atmospheric video. And this water vapor in the atmosphere eventually, as Earth cooled, cooled and condensed out of the atmosphere to form the early oceans. Also, to see more about how the Earth's rocks and atmosphere even contained water to begin with, or was delivered water by impacts and stuff, I talk way more about that and all the contributing processes that brought Earth water in my How Earth Got Water video. So I'll link that at the top right if you're interested. But anyway, in this video, we will be going over the ocean's composition. And to do that, I will be doing kind of three sections. The first, salinity, the second over nutrients, and the third, we'll finish out with the gases and kind of gas exchange with the atmosphere and stuff. So first and foremost, the ocean is saline because rivers deliver salts and nutrients and stuff to the ocean from terrestrial systems. Essentially, continental weathering, right, rain and rivers and other, you know, terrestrial hydrosphere-type systems lead to the dissolution and transport of salt ions like chlorine, sodium, sulfate, calcium, potassium, magnesium, bicarbonate, and other things to the ocean, which leads to its salinity. So you might wonder, well, the ocean has been receiving this influx of river water for the entirety of Earth's history ever since it formed. So does that mean that the salinity of the ocean has been constantly increasing with zero declines throughout Earth's history? No, actually, this is one of the reasons that early scientists underestimated Earth's age. They actually calculated the time required for oceans to reach their current salinity level, but they forgot to consider salt removal. They only considered the input of salt to the ocean without considering the fact that it actually is removed from the ocean through various processes. We know now that salts are largely removed from the ocean due to precipitation of minerals, of salt-containing minerals, which basically leads to their trapping in the geosphere in rocks, and eventually they go through a cycle like anything else, like we've been talking about in the past few videos about biogeochemical cycles and whatnot, and they're just like that. They go through cycles. It's not just a one unidirectional type of process. Hardly anything is on Earth. And I'll talk more about the sinks or removal processes of salts from the ocean in a later slide. But this is actually why less reactive and more soluble ions like sodium and chlorine are most abundant in the ocean and least spatially variable across the oceans, because the less reactive they are, the less likely it is they react with something and precipitate out as a mineral and go into the geosphere. And the more soluble they are, obviously it kind of goes hand in hand, they, you know, remain dissolved in the water. The graph here is showing essentially solubility. This was in a book that I scanned. That's why you see like partial notes that I wrote cut off here. But I just wrote essentially solubility on the x-axis. And you can see with increasing solubility, there's an increase in mean residence time, which just means the amount of time an ion stays in the ocean before it is removed. Calcium, on the other hand, is an example where it is really abundant, dominant in river water and input to the ocean, but since it's used by marine life like corals, sponges, mollusks, algae, etc. to build calcium carbonate skeletons, it is not the most abundant in the seawater because it is used up for that, and that is one of the ways that it is removed from the water. But salinity in the oceans is not a spatially consistent value. Yes, the oceans have an average salinity, but salinity actually varies quite a bit across different ocean basins. These variations are due to an imbalance between freshwater input and evaporation or output. For example, because evaporation exceeds the input of river water and rain into the Atlantic is more saline than the Pacific. And this salinity imbalance is actually becoming more extreme due to climate change. Low salinity areas are becoming lower in salinity, and high salinity areas are becoming higher. But ocean salinity hasn't only varied spatially, it also has varied temporally through Earth's history. For example, during glacial periods versus non-glacial greenhouse periods, when glaciers and ice have spread, obviously they take up a lot of the fresh water, and that increases the leftover water's salinity. Additionally, periods of increased continental weathering, for example, also increase salinity because more continental weathering means more input of salt ions to the ocean. So what are the salt sinks, or the processes that remove salt from the oceans? Like I mentioned earlier, the more reactive salt ions can react and precipitate out as minerals. In other words, just form solid minerals, like for example, sodium and chlorine ions can react to form sodium chloride or table salt. Another process, though, that is a sink for ocean salts or salt ions is biological uptake. For example, like we mentioned earlier, a lot of corals, mollusks, etc. form skeletons using calcium carbonate. They secrete calcium carbonate. And to do this, they have to take up a lot of ions like calcium and bicarbonate. And the last major process that removes salts from the ocean is adsorption to mineral surfaces or organic particles. Adsorption is with a D instead of a B, because instead of something absorbing into something, adsorption is just a surface process where it essentially kind of gets stuck to the outside. In chemistry, this can vary depending on the exact adsorption process, but essentially it's the surface adsorption of ions to mineral surfaces, which removes them. It kind of leads them to sink to the bottom and get buried with the other sediments, and it removes them from being dissolved in the ocean water column. But rivers are not the only source of salts to the ocean. There is also kind of an internal source of other ions and stuff to the ocean, and that is underwater volcanoes or hydrothermal vents, which occur near mid-ocean ridges where ocean crust is spreading apart and new crust is coming up from the asthenosphere and building on the lithosphere. And at these, you know, divergent plate boundaries, obviously there's a lot of, you know, activity. There's new crust coming up, so there's a lot of volcanic activity that is venting out a lot of ions from the Earth's interior. In fact, 80% of Earth's volcanic activity occurs on the seafloor. I actually didn't know that before researching for this video, and I find that really interesting. And these vents release volcanic gases like water, CO2, methane, hydrogen sulfide, sulfate, and also ions like calcium, iron, manganese, and a bunch of other constituents. And these ions react with the other ions present in the water, in the seawater, in the surrounding water, which is often a very different composition than the vent fluid. And vent fluids can change drastically depending on the type of kind of lithosphere that they are in. There's very much reducing type like iron sulfide or pyrite rich vents, which are called black smokers and can be higher temperature and more acidic. And then there's white smokers, which are in, to my understanding, like calcium carbonate rich sediments. And yeah, so there's different types and compositions of hydrothermal vents and vent fluid, and therefore they can cause different precipitation of different minerals depending on what they're venting out and what those ions are reacting with in the surrounding water. In any case, one consistent reaction that we see at mid-ocean ridges where new crust is forming is that when the seawater reacts with the newly forming ocean crust, magnesium ions are exchanged with calcium ions from the newly forming basalt. And this decreases, over time, the global ocean magnesium-calcium ratio. So why is this useful? Well, we can actually track periods in Earth's history with low versus high average magnesium-calcium ratios in the ocean by looking at the magnesium-to-calcium ratios preserved in calcium carbonate skeletons of mollusks or corals or whatever other fossils have calcium carbonate skeletons. And that is because, yes, they're made up of calcium carbonate, but they do substitute some manganese into their structures. And with that, we can get an idea of the average manganese calcium ratios of the ocean as long as you know like how much manganese should be substituted in whatever various, you know, mollusk shell or coral skeleton that you're looking at. And then, you know, once you correct for that, you can get an idea of how the magnesium to calcium ratio has changed in the ocean over time, and therefore also get an idea of how mid-ocean ridge spreading rates have changed over time. In other words, increased rates of mid-ocean ridge spreading would therefore lead to a lower magnesium to calcium ratio found in the rock record, and slower spreading rates would lead to a higher magnesium to calcium ratio. Increased spreading rates also increased sea level, and this would help us also to reconstruct and understand paleoclimate better, understanding what we're seeing in the rest of the rock record globally. If we're seeing transgression or sea level rise, does that make sense with the climate? Was it perhaps an increase in spreading rates that caused this, or something else? So this is a really helpful tool to use to reconstruct certain aspects of Earth's history. These magnesium-calcium ratios, though, also greatly affect the marine biosphere because they control what kinds of calcium carbonate skeletons can be produced more favorably, per se. This basically is just because different organisms produce or secrete different calcium carbonate minerals. Now, all of the calcium carbonate minerals that organisms typically use, aragonite and calcite, are calcium carbonate. They're the same chemical formula, but they're made in different structures. And calcite actually has some variant different structures and compositions. For example, LMC is what we call low magnesium calcite, whereas HMC is high magnesium calcite. And these have slightly different, obviously, magnesium ratios and structures. And there are organisms that more favorably produce one of these types of minerals over the other. And therefore, in periods where the magnesium-calcium ratio is low or less than two, like in times in Earth's history, this favored the production of low magnesium calcite. Whereas like in modern day oceans where the magnesium-calcium ratio is high, this favors the production of high magnesium calcite and aragonite, which is obviously favoring different organisms because different organisms produce that stuff. So it greatly affects the marine biosphere, and I talk more about this and how this kind of magnesium-calcium ratio affects marine life in my carbonate chemistry video, something about, you know, different carbonate minerals. I don't remember what I called it, but I'll link it to the top right for you. And now moving to ocean nutrients before we get to the final part about gases, and I won't be too long about these. Salinity was the big section. So with nutrients, you've got macronutrients, micronutrients, both of which vary both spatially and temporally in the oceans. These nutrients drive primary productivity or photosynthesis and algal blooms at the ocean surface. And then, you know, once the algae has kind of worked in these nutrients into, you know, their biomass, then these nutrients cycle through the marine food chain. Some of the organic matter produced will get past, you know, decomposition or use by other organisms and buried in the marine sediments. But most of it will continue to get decomposed and cycled through the marine ecosystems. Primary productivity, though, is actually very variable depending on where in the ocean on Earth we're looking. It's concentrated in coastal regions due to much higher nutrient input from terrestrial sources. Like I mentioned in the previous video about ocean circulation, upwelling is a vertical mixing process in the ocean that brings nutrients from the deep water to the ocean surface and drives primary productivity. Likewise, downwelling, or the sinking of the surface waters to the deep waters, delivers oxygen to the deep waters, driving organic matter decomposition and cycling. However, upwelling and downwelling in terms of their strength, in terms of mixing the ocean surface and deep waters, has changed throughout Earth's history. And one of the things that affects upwelling and downwelling strength is warming and cooling. During periods of global warming, this weakens atmospheric and ocean temperature gradients and thus circulation, since temperature gradient drives pretty much all circulation in the atmospheres and oceans. And this leads to weaker upwelling and downwelling, and this leads to more stratified oceans. In other words, more limited mixing between the surface and deep waters. This ocean stratification leads to ocean anoxia, or the lack of oxygen, especially in the deep oceans that are not getting the downwelling to deliver oxygen to them from the surface waters, and this contributes greatly to the decline of marine animal life, because like terrestrial animals, marine life also needs oxygen. We've seen this many times in Earth's history, like I mentioned in the last video, during the Cretaceous and for a time in the Jurassic, though there was weakened temperature gradients from equator to poles, which led to weakened mixing in the oceans and thus stratification and deep ocean anoxia. And lastly, we will talk about the gases in the ocean, specifically ocean atmospheric gas exchange. Other than those gases that are delivered to the ocean through hydrothermal vents, gases are also added through the exchange of atmospheric gases to the oceans. All the gases that are present in our atmosphere today are also present in the ocean. For example, nitrogen, oxygen, and carbon dioxide. But they differ in their relative abundances due to differences in their solubility and biological requirements. Microbes at the ocean's surface, in algal blooms and whatnot, fix atmospheric nitrogen, in other words, take up atmospheric nitrogen and convert it to other bioavailable nitrogen compounds or compounds that are usable for other life, essentially mixing it into the marine food chain. And they also take up, obviously, carbon dioxide for photosynthesis, and this actually leads to carbon dioxide being the dominant gas in the surface ocean, despite having a relatively low concentration in our atmosphere. For context, the atmosphere contains about 78% nitrogen, 21% oxygen, and about 1% other stuff, and a pretty small amount of that last 1% is carbon dioxide. So it's has a relatively low concentration in the atmosphere, but a very high one at the surface ocean where all this algae is taking it up for primary productivity. And again, this is something that also varies spatially throughout the ocean. Carbon dioxide obviously being more concentrated in those regions where primary productivity is more productive. And through photosynthesis, they produce oxygen, leading to relatively evenly distributed oxygen-rich surface waters. However, this atmospheric ocean gas exchange is leading to carbon dioxide concentrations in the ocean increasing due to those in the atmosphere that are increasing. And this is changing the ocean's pH. This is causing what people call ocean acidification. Now, the ocean is alkaline in its actual pH. It is relatively on the basic side of things. It's not an acid. However, it is acidifying, becoming more acidic, due to the increase in CO2. The more CO2 goes into the ocean, the more it reacts with water and forms carbonic acid, and essentially the more protons are in the ocean. And acidity is essentially just a measure of hydrogen ions or protons. The higher the concentration, the more acidic. And this is leading to calcium carbonate minerals being harder to produce, essentially. It's pushing the equilibrium reaction that we see here to the right, in other words, toward the dissolution side of things, meaning that marine life that secrete calcium carbonate as their skeletons are going to have a harder and harder time making their skeletons the more the ocean's pH decreases. So it goes without saying that this is bad for marine ecosystems, especially because calcium carbonate is so commonly used among marine life like corals, mollusks, and sponges. And what makes it worse is that carbon dioxide solubility increases in cold and deep waters. So even though the surface corals are relatively safe from, you know, really bad acidification because that warmer water can't hold as much CO2, they are warming and that's causing the expulsion of their algae, their symbiotic algae, and therefore bleaching. And the deeper corals are exposed to this drastic increase in CO2 levels and decreasing pH, which is dissolving them, essentially. With that, if you guys enjoyed learning about the ocean's composition and how it's changed and all of that, I will say there is another video coming about ocean, how the ocean's currently changing and like all the ways it's changing and why and what's that gonna cause and all this stuff. I think I'm gonna make that like a short video, so we'll see. If it's out by now, I'll try to link it up here. If not, go check out my previous one about circulation if you have not yet, because that one and this one kind of go hand in hand. But anyway, like always, my references are linked down below in the description box, and I can't wait to see you guys in the next one. Bye.